Will you raise your hand? Ah. So you all stayed out past your bedtime. Welcome to the youth night. We're super happy to be here with you guys as well. Woo! Yeah. Let's give it up for Jesus, huh? Let me just read this passage. It's the one that I messed up earlier. I pressed next on my Kindle, so. Revelation 12, verse 10. And it says this, "And I heard a loud voice in heaven saying, now is the salvation and the power and the kingdom of our God and the authority of his Christ have come. For the accuser, the devil, of our brothers has been thrown down, who accuses them day and night before our God. And they have overcome him," that's us, "overcome him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. For they love not their lives even unto death." I'll read that part again. And they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. Jesus' blood, the blood of the Lamb, overcomes sin and death. Amen? Let's all just stand. This night's going to be, you know, we'll try to do some music, kind of invite everybody to sing. We hope you know all these songs. Maybe some of them you don't know, but they're super easy to catch on to. This first song we did last year. And then we're going to have, after this first set, some testimonies. And then, you know, some later. And the word's going to be preached. And then we're going to have the prayer team to be able to pray for anybody and anybody who wants prayer. That sounds like a good night to me. How about you guys? Okay, so we sang this song last year. It's called Only King Forever. So for all the older generation, let's sing this first chorus a cappella. How about that?
You are the only King forever. Almighty God, you lift you higher. You are the only King forever. Forevermore, you are victorious. Thank you.
cooperating with each other, okay? Turn to the left and the right. Say, God is good.
Hallelujah.
One, two, three. Whoa! It's pretty easy.
Join
guys.
Us.
Whoa! Whoa! Whoa!
Sing it out.
You are my vision, O King of my heart. Nothing else satisfies, only you, Lord. You are my best thought, by day or by night. Waking or sleeping, your presence, my God. Dwell inside me, together we're one. You are my battle shield, sword for the fight. You are my dignity, you're my delight. You're my soul. You're my high tower. Come raise me heavenward, O power of my crown. I don't want nations or man's empty.
We want nothing else but your inheritance, no riches of this world. Ah. So Lord, we just look forward to all the stories we're going to hear, because they are all a testament to how good you are, because you are good forever, and your mercy endures forever, and our lives are a living testament to that, Lord. So Father, we thank you, we praise you as the only King forever. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you guys for worshiping with us. Let's take a seat. Let's get a little more, you know, comfortable here. So as we said, like, we're kind of just continuing the spirit of the schools. Nathan, could you bring your yellow mic down there? So we kind of said earlier, we want to hear stories that can encourage us, that can call us to action, that can just tell of God's goodness, you know? So this time is just reserved for that. So whoever wants to, usually it takes a little time for the first guy to go, and then it, like, doesn't stop after that. So whoever wants to come up and share.
Awesome.
And I want to talk about how God has worked at my heart through somebody else's broken heart. As you guys know, some of you guys may know, I posted on my Facebook. It was on the scores page. But my boss of 4 years was diagnosed. His heart was failing. Somebody, he's also my relative and super close to our family. He was 29 when he found out that his heart wasn't functioning as the rest of us. And he went to the doctors. They put a pacemaker. They realized that that wasn't good enough. And slowly, slowly, his heart was failing, and it was pleading to God, like, why him? In 2014, at the beginning, he finally got put on the list for the heart donation, and it takes about a year and a half to get a heart that matches you. You have to be, no other thing can be wrong with you. You have to have money, and basically it takes about a year and a half. And it was in March, and I was getting ready to come to North Carolina and Florida. And at that time, I was getting ready to finish school, and I kind of didn't know where God wanted to lead me, and I didn't know where my life was going. I was kind of like at a point where I was asking God, you know, what am I going to do from now on? And I was kind of broken. And a couple days before I was leaving on my trip, he got a phone call. They found a match for his heart. He's 33, and he went to the hospital. I was leaving to fly here. And it was about 3 days after he got surgery, and the heart that he got wasn't responding. It was like 20% that was responding. He was pleading for his life. He was pleading to the doctors, why me? Don't let me die. He has two kids. At the time, they were three and five. He's been carrying a battery pack where he couldn't shower, he couldn't go swimming, he couldn't run, he couldn't teach his kids how to play sports, how to ride a bike, nothing. And his heart was failing, and he was in the room pleading for God. He was in and out of consciousness. God, please save me. And I was driving with Ruth in the car. We were going to West Palm, and I turned around to her and I said, Ruth, why? Like, I believe in God, but he's not answering. Like, I'm praying super hard, and a lot of people are praying. It's on the Discord's page. Like, people in Canada know, like, and he's dying. And I kind of doubted God at that moment. Like, what are you doing, God? And I sat in silence, and at the same exact time, I wrote his wife I texted her a Bible verse, and it says, because he loves me, says the Lord, I will rescue him. I will protect him, for he acknowledges my name. He will call upon me, and I will answer. I will be with him in trouble. I will deliver him and honor him with long life, and I satisfy him and show him my salvation. I sat in silence in the car as we drove, and I got on Facebook, and the first post was that a miracle happened. He got a second heart. The doctors have never seen anything like this. The hospital haven't seen. For you to get a heart and basically a second heart in about a week, they haven't heard about it. Wesley, he got a new heart. It was his fifth open heart surgery. It's been 6 months till then. He's walking. He drives a car. He's back to work. So God fixed his heart. And I looked at my life since the six months, and God has really blessed me, and I've seen his love and for me and more than I can imagine. And I was sitting here getting ready for Desculti tonight. I didn't know if I was going to get up here or not, but I opened the Bible. I just opened it, and it was the same verse that I texted his wife when he was getting ready to go through the surgery again. So, and, you know, we pray, and God hears us. Like, just because you're praying and he's not answering a day or two doesn't mean he doesn't listen and doesn't hear our prayers. So I want to encourage everyone to keep praying.
My story involves an angry father who in a moment of weakness, told to his gross, because of what you did, you brought shame to me. I don't want to see you anymore. Two of his girls moved in an apartment in the same city. They still kept in touch with the mother through the phone somewhat, and to the rest of the brothers they met. But I came to their city, and I became friends with one of these two girls who were staying away from their parents. And after a while, our relationship got more serious, so I had to talk to the father about future plans. But I didn't know all the backstory, so when I told her, we're going to go together to talk to your father about this, and she started crying, no, I can't see my father, no, you don't understand. But eventually she came, and so we talked to him. She was crying the whole time. A while passed, and we broke up. It didn't work out. But I said, I need to talk to her father. If it didn't work out with me, maybe it works out with him, like to have a family again. So I texted all my friends, and I told them, guys, here's what I'm going to do. I think God wants to do something special in this family. I'm going to fast for 3 days. That's how I understand, putting your heart into it. Fasted for 3 days, and I said, if you guys, my friends, want to fast with me, that's fine. If not, I'll still do it. But please pray with me. I want God to protect me. I'm going to talk to this man, and I know his reputation. He's a very stubborn man. He's set. He doesn't want to let go a little bit. So I went and talked with him, and as I was talking with him I was trying to tell him why I came there. I realized I don't even have to convince him that he was ready to receive what I was telling him. And he said, and I told him, your own daughters, they're afraid of you. They think that you hate them. And he said, oh no, that's not what I wanted to do. I was angry that day. I said some words that I regretted. It's been a year or 2 years since that event when he said, I never want to see you again. And of course, he never called to apologize. But I said, you know what? I think your daughters want to see you. And he was telling his wife, call them to come back home right now. And I told him, no, that's not how you do it. You have to go yourself to give them a hug, to tell them you love them, and you're sorry for what you did. And I left. I don't know what he did that day, but I found out later that the girls came back home, and they had Thanksgiving dinner. The whole family was reunited, and I think that was God working. And I was just a vessel. But praise God.
I wasn't planning on saying anything, but Justin called me out earlier, and he said I have to share. So, last year, I came up here, and I think I talked a little bit about depression and loneliness, and how it's something that like is very prevalent in our community, especially in the society that we live in, and it's very stigmatized. It's very easy to look down and feel rejected by your own churches, your own community, because depression is not something that's very well understood. And I don't really want to talk about that. I just wanted to kind of, just reflecting back on my life in the past year and a half, I wanted to talk a little bit about crises of faith. Sometimes in our spiritual life, we have ups and we have downs, and there are times where the evil one attacks you with thoughts and ways of thinking that aren't necessarily good for you. Not this summer, but the summer before that, I went through what was probably the worst crisis of faith in my entire life. And I was at the point where, sitting alone, going through depression and a number of other things, I was near the verge of rejecting the concept of Christ. I don't know how it could have happened to me as a person, who has grown up and has believed something like this my entire life, to come to the conclusion, man, I don't even know if I believe this anymore. It was a very complicated series of events that led to me to get to that point, but I was alone. I didn't really have anybody to support me, nobody that I could share my struggles and my troubles with. And at that moment, I just wanted to share, the second I had this thought that God does not exist, that I am alone in the universe, I felt the most cold sense of loneliness I've ever felt in my entire life, as if everything was meaningless and everything was worthless and nothing made sense, and it was so devastating to live life without God. It was just, I was nothing. What is the point of existing if there isn't a God? And these kinds of thoughts went through my mind, and I sat down praying, and I think I had my ukulele. I was at work in my office. It was a Sunday night. It's complicated. But I sat down praying, and I just picked up the song, and I started to play. There's one of my favorite Christian songs. It's an old hymn that has this haunting melody that just kind of spoke to me. And God sometimes speaks to us through different mediums. And for me, it's oftentimes through art and through music. Some people, it's through science and logic. But for some people, it's God speaks to you in different ways. And it's the song, On a Hill Far Away. And I remember I just started playing it to myself. And it's just something about that melody. I got down on my knees crying, and I just, sitting there, lost in my thoughts, I was hoping, God, I need to know. And one word popped into my mind, one word that I could just barely hold on to. That all of the foundations of my Christian faith had rotted away. I could imagine I was standing on a table, and one leg rotted. That's the leg of prayer. I wasn't really praying anymore. My prayer life was gone. I was like, I might as well not even pray, because the same things are going to happen. That's what was going on through my mind. The leg of community had rotted away. The leg of the church and the people that were around me, I wasn't really involved, and I felt very alienated and isolated from my church because of what I was going through. And finally, I had struggles and doubts about the leg of the Bible. And suddenly, the table started to collapse. What was I standing on? What was the foundation of my faith? And God gave me a word, something that struck me. And I started, it was the word that just popped into my mind, Abiogenesis.